This is awesome.
This is awesome. Hey, good to see you, man. This is your first
Thank you. Rebecca Ingram. Our project, the Ingram New Works Project, gets more and more exciting every year. We enjoy it more and more every year. You may be aware that we just ended our main stage season with the production of David Auburn's The Columnist, which is a play that got its start in our festival in 2010. We're about to launch next season with the world premiere of a new comedy that was written in last year's lab called Larry's by Nate Epler. So as you can see, this project is really hopping. It's becoming very important to us, and we're really, really glad to have you here and to have your support of it. Before we get started tonight, there are a couple other thank yous I need to say. First of all, I need to say thanks to our friends at HowlRound TV for live streaming this on the internet. I also need to remind you that subscriptions are for sale. If you want one, you can get them online at our website. I also want to alert you to a fundraising party that we're doing on May 19th called River Reprise. It's going to be a spectacular evening of food and drink and hanging out with all the actors and musicians who helped make our season so successful, so we hope you'll support us by coming and partying with us. And I also want to let you know that we're actually doing a workshop production of Larry's in June. In other words, we did the reading a year ago, we're doing full production in the fall, so this workshop production is intended to give Nate one more developmental step before we get into full production in the fall. And so if you're one of those people who are a fan of the play, you saw it last year, you're intending to see it in its full production in the fall, you might enjoy coming to see this intermediate step. That'll be the last Saturday in June. So we'll make sure that that information is up on our website as the time nears as well, so we hope to see you then. I also need to let you know this play has one intermission, and during that time we hope you buy lots and lots of candy. The proceeds support our professional internship program, and if you'll go ahead and check your cell phones right now and make sure they're silenced, we would all really, really appreciate that. Okay, so a quick overview of the project goes like this. It has three parts. One part is the fellowship, the Ingram New Works Fellowship. This year, our Ingram New Works Fellow is Theresa Rebeck, which we're very, very pleased with. Theresa is awesome. We offer that fellowship every year to a playwright at Nashville Review, whose work we admire and who we think is going to continue to make great contributions to the American theater. The second prong of this three-prong program is the Ingram New Works Lab. This is an ongoing lab, a season-long lab that is intended to support the work of regional and local playwrights who are working on a brand new play from its very, very start. At the beginning of the lab, we have four members of the Ingram New Works Lab this year, and I'd like to introduce them at this point. So say hello to Nate Epler.
Outside in Joy's university office. There's very little delineation between these spaces. They may be suggested merely by the objects in them. Antiques, books, clocks, an old electric typewriter. These spaces are not messy, but architectural in their clutter. The garden must contain real dirt. Joy, in a spotlight. She's in the middle of a lecture.
If you had a time machine, where would you go? Okay, before some of you go all Doctor Who on me, remember that it's a perfectly rational philosophical question. Einstein tells us that time is a thing, not a flowing river, but a frozen one. A full-on dimension that we can't access because our consciousness is literally frozen into it. Some philosophers postulate that time travel is not only possible, but necessary. Because if it weren't, they argue, we couldn't even conceive of it. Our memories would bear no significance. We wouldn't look for meaning in them. We wouldn't understand cause and effect. So let's assume, for the sake of today's class, that time travel, while fraught with paradox and pop culture bullshit, is not only possible, but very, very real. Where would you go? What would you do? How many of you would go back and kill Hitler? Raise your hands. That's the most popular answer. Also one of the most dubious, in my opinion, but that's another conversation. How many of you want to see the future? Flying cars, teleportation, the end of the sun, the end of the universe? How many of you want something else?
In silhouette, Joy's mother, George, appears.
Joy, honey, what is it? Are you okay? What's wrong?
I know where I'd go. I'd go back to the moment I fell off the earth.
Honey, come here. What happened? You're shaking all over.
As a kid, I was plagued with thoughts, huge thoughts, and most days it seemed my little brain couldn't contain them all. I marveled at ordinary things. I'd stare at my hand and try to grasp the present moment, what it means to be alive, really alive, right now. Right now.
It's okay, baby. I've got you.
And I used to stargaze. I grew up in the suburbs before there was light pollution, so I was treated to some amazing skies. One night when I was 11, I decided to teach myself the constellations. I spread out a blanket, collected my star chart and my little flashlight with red cellophane, and I lay down and looked up. I arched my back so that everything in my peripheral vision disappeared. All I saw was stars, nothing but stars. My eyes were telescopes, up and up and up and farther and farther and farther.
Get under the blanket with me.
The ground beneath me fell away. My heart beat so fast and I couldn't catch my breath. The sky was overpowering and I was falling into it, and oh my God, I loved it. It was better than the best roller coaster. I've never felt so exhilarated in my life.
That must have been some nightmare.
But I couldn't catch my breath. I couldn't breathe, and I couldn't slow my heart, and all of it was so big, so immense, and I was so small, and I loved it. I did, but it also terrified me.
What do you mean, honey? What can I do for you?
And I ran inside and woke up my mom.
Chocolate chip cookies? Are you insane? It's 2 a.m.
I woke up my mom, and we made chocolate chip cookies together in the middle of the night, and we ate them. And she held me, and we watched the sun rise together. If I had a time machine, I'd go back there.
Pain is beauty. Beauty is pain. The pain will fade, but the beauty remains.
What does that mean?
It means women do all kinds of things to ourselves to look beautiful. Piercing ears, pulling out pantyhose, wearing high heels, plucking eyebrows.
And those awful brush rollers you make me sleep in before holidays and school pictures?
Your hair stays curly all day, doesn't it? So the pain only lasts for a bit.
It lasts all night! I can't sleep with those things in my hair.
But the beauty lasts forever. When I pluck a stray hair, it hurts for just a second, but it won't grow back for a few weeks, get it?
But don't you just have to pluck it again?
You know what? You're too smart for your own good.
I want to look like you when I grow up.
Why?
Because you're perfect. But you're forgetting something.
Don't rush me. It is the last thing. Now, where is it?
She opens the drawer and digs. She finds a small bottle of perfume.
Here it is.
It's Chanel number 5. Say it.
Special occasions only.
No, the other thing.
Ah. Share the fantasy.
Mark sprays into the air and then steps into the mist and twirls.
I love that smell.
Me too, it's my favorite.
You should wear it all the time, every day.
I can't.
Why not?
It's too expensive. I spent most of my first paycheck on this bottle, and look, I still have half of it left. You have to be frugal with your indulgences.
What's frugal?
Not wasteful, economical.
What are indulgences?
Things that are extravagant, over the top.
Like your perfume.
And your questions.
Oh wait, here it comes.
Funny baby thinks I'm gonna walk all over you.
Don't know what you've got till it's gone. Appreciate everything you have. when you have it, because it won't last forever.
Why not?
Nothing lasts forever.
You'll last forever.
You think so?
Yeah.
Why is that?
Because you're my mom.
Regardless, I think the point is that we should appreciate each other every day. Doesn't that sound like a good idea?
Yep. Where are you going tonight?
Out.
With a boyfriend?
He's not a boyfriend yet.
Do you want him to be a boyfriend?
It depends.
On what?
On what he does when I tell him about you.
What does that matter?
Trust me, honey, it matters. Oh, that reminds me. Look what I found today.
She crosses to a box and pulls out a photograph, a snapshot.
It's a picture. The four of us, the Gallagher women.
The club!
That's right. Your grandma, your great-grandma, me and you.
Oh, my tongue's sticking out.
You were 2 months old.
When was this taken?
Bobby's 50th anniversary party.
I miss her.
Me too.
Why haven't I seen this before?
I found it in a box full of pictures of landscapes and buildings that nobody wanted. Would you like to keep it?
Really?
Sure.
Aren't you going to put it in your special album?
I think it's time you start your own album. Someone's got a birthday coming up. You could ask for a camera.
Really? My own camera?
Why not? You're old enough. Now you be good. Grandma tonight, okay? Don't stay up too late.
What's wrong, Mom?
I feel like I'm forgetting something.
Your necklace.
Oh, right! My pearls! And what would I do without you?
She kisses Joy on the head and roots around in her jewelry box. Lights shift. And old George is revealed.
Where did it go? It's too bright and it's too tight and it's still choking me. Make it go now. Make it stop.
Young George finds the necklace.
These were your Bobby's wedding pearls.
Special occasion only?
You bet.
It chokes me and if it doesn't stop, I'm going to explode into a million tiny pieces.
Young George puts the necklace on. It breaks and pearls spill onto the table.
Oh, shit! Oh, no!
What happened?
Help me! Joy!
Young George frantically searches for pearls.
It's so much, and each one shines like a tiny planet, and it's so cold and tight, then it just blows up in my face.
I think one rolled under the table.
I'm so scared, because the only thing that helps is to stare at the pictures that the red glass bottles make on the bathroom wall.
I don't see it.
They're so pretty.
Oh, wait, I found it.
When I find it, I'll hide all the little pieces of me in those glass bottles. I'll bury them so nobody can find them until it's time.
Here you go, Mom. Joy gives young George the pearl.
Those were your great-grandmothers. They were so old.
It hurts, Joy.
I know, Mom. It'll be okay.
What am I going to do?
Can't you fix it?
The pain makes me cry sometimes.
It won't be the same.
Can you help me?
Young George puts the pearls in her jewelry box.
Nothing lasts forever. Huh.
She looks at her reflection in the mirror. Her reflection is old George.
Crow's feet already. Oh. I swear, Joy, I'm decomposing in front of you.
No, you're not. You're beautiful, Mom.
I love you, sweetheart. Be good.
Young George kisses Joy on the top of her head and exits.
Shh. Do you hear?
Mom?
Listen. Me. It's me.
Lights fade. Lights rise on Joy's office. Michael enters. What the hell?
Calm down.
Don't tell me to calm down. The balls on that kid. I mean, the size of his balls must weigh him down so much that his back must be in constant pain from the sheer size of his balls. No wonder he shuffles down the hall like a Neanderthal, little prick.
Little prick, big balls.
Yeah.
You done?
Not yet. She opens the door and shouts into the hallway. The egocentric little asshole! She slams the door and sits. Now I'm done.
It's a good thing you have tenure. What exactly did the dean say?
Nothing. Sat there, silent, while Mr. Hipster Glasses accused me of bias in the classroom.
Bias?
Bias. Liberal bias.
Seriously?
Out of nowhere! I'm walking down the hall, and the dean says, "Can I see you for a moment, Dr. Gallagher?" And I say, "Sure, Dean Thomas." And I walk into his office, oblivious, and this kid is sitting there, all fucking self-important, and I'm ambushed.
How is space and time political?
How the hell should I know? Beyond the fact that the entire academy is some depraved lair designed solely for brainwashing innocent young minds with tainted liberal agendas, like knowledge, ooh,
that's so bad.
Joy.
Like pursuing knowledge and challenging preconceived notions is a threat to the very foundations of this republic.
I can't talk to you when you're like this.
Then maybe you should go. Okay, you're right. Don't go.
Just take a breath.
But I mean...
Then do it. Now, calmly, rationally, which kid was it?
Intro class, Mick Jagger. I still can't believe that's his name. What were his parents thinking?
Did he file an official complaint?
I don't think so. It was just an informal conversation. He told the dean that I assault his values in class, that I never let the other side give their opinion.
Other side of what?
Exactly!
What did he say? What did you say?
I said that I'd be happy to listen to his opinion if he'd ever raise his hand, which he never does. And then he said that he's not comfortable raising his hand. He says everyone knows I'm an atheist and I'll dock their grades if they don't agree with me.
It's bullshit.
What's worse is that the dean didn't stand up for me, Michael. He sat back in his chair, nodding while this kid attacked me. Me! Winner of the Excellence in Teaching Award 2 years in a row!
So what now?
He decided that it would be a good idea for him to sit in on my next few classes for a review. He wants to make sure I'm encouraging a positive and comfortable learning environment.
He's cake.
That's not the point.
What is the point?
Do you think he would have said that if I were a man?
Come on, Joy.
Think about it, Michael. Are male professors expected to provide positive and comfortable learning environments?
Not usually.
Exactly! I tried to imagine how that conversation would have gone down with a male professor like Caldwell, and I couldn't see it.
Caldwell's a douche.
Again, not the point.
His lectures are boring as hell.
You're avoiding the question. Would the dean have accused Caldwell of bias?
No. But he doesn't challenge his students. You do.
I think they expect me to be these kids' mother.
You are, in a way.
That's not fair. I worked my ass off to get here.
All I'm saying is that students naturally see you differently.
Because I'm a woman.
Yes. And that's not a slam. It's just a fact.
I had to work twice as hard as my male colleagues to be taken seriously in this field. I had no female mentors in graduate school. I was the only woman in 20 miles of the science program. I did nothing but fight to be taken seriously. That's it. I'm tired of the fighting, I'm tired of the glazed eyes and the, is this going to be on the test, and the texting and the pajama pants and all the goddamn irony. I'm done.
Really? I know 50 people who would kill for your job.
Call them up. They can have it.
The students aren't the enemy. They get so much of that least common denominator everywhere they turn. Nobody expects anything from them. Nobody gives a rat's ass about them. They're just numbers and tuition payments and 4-year graduation statistics. You care about them, and the way you care is by not expecting anything less from them than their absolute best. They're not used to that kind of responsibility, but it works. You reach them. I can think of at least 20 undergraduates who'd be willing to put everything on the line for you. This is nothing.
No, it's not nothing. It's a fucking waste of time. I don't have time for this.
Unless you want to wind up flipping burgers at Jack in the Box, you'll find time. Now, man up, smile pretty for the dean, and go in there tomorrow and blow his fucking mind.
Man up? Did you seriously just tell me to man up?
Yep.
Fuck you very much.
You're welcome.
Just out of curiosity, what's our good buddy Mick Jagger getting in the class?
Let's find out, shall we?
Michael crosses the computer and clicks.
Hey, you get off of my cloud!
Shut up.
Oh, looky here, a D. You didn't take the last quiz.
Figures. My head hurts. She lays down on the couch. Michael crosses to her and sits. He rubs her temples.
How's that?
Awesome.
I wanted to be a professor my whole life. Actually, I take that back. When I was 8, I wanted to be an astronaut.
Well, yeah? What happened?
Claustrophobia.
That would kind of get in the way, wouldn't it?
Yeah. I had to settle for the big spaces inside my head. That's nice.
You know what you need?
What?
Break.
Oh, yeah?
Sure. Come to the bar tonight.
You know I can't do that.
Why not? You can just hang out.
I don't think it's a good idea.
Why?
You know why. I don't know why you still work there.
It's a nice place. People are real down to earth. You'd know that if you ever came in to visit me.
What's that supposed to mean?
I mean, they don't talk about entropy and entanglement and the many worlds interpretation.
I like talking about entanglement.
So do I, but that's all you do, Joy. I'm saying there's a time and a place for it, and there's a time and a place for a good beer and a bad joke.
And a hot bartender?
That too.
Joy rises and closes her office door.
Tell you what, let's practice your defense.
My defense?
Your dissertation. Chapter 4.
Now?
Yes. Now. Entropy. Go.
Are you sure this is a good idea?
Why not?
It's 3 o'clock. Hallway's full of students. You have office hours.
So? You're my TA. You're supposed to be in my office. Go on.
Quantum. Spin. Liquid.
She puts her hands under his shirt.
More.
Order to disorder. Homogeneity bursting into dynamic diversity.
Oh. Turn it off.
You're turning me on, Dr. Donahue.
Not a doctor yet.
Then let's play doctor.
Are you sure about this?
Oh, yes. Definitely. Yes.
Then keep it under 10 decibels, okay? I really don't want to get caught.
They kiss. Things progress. Joy's office phone rings.
Don't you dare.
It could be about the NIH grant. Joy Gallagher. Mrs. Peterson? How did you get this number? What's wrong? Slow down, I don't understand. She's where? She's doing what? Well, did you tell her to go back inside? It's just, she gets confused. No, don't call the police. Don't, I'm coming right home. I'll be there in 20 minutes, just 20 minutes.
What's that about?
Nothing, just a problem with my dog.
You know you had a dog?
I do, a little. She got out and wrecked my neighbor's flowers. Can you take the afternoon seminar?
Sure. Are you okay?
I'm fine. Everything's fine. Fine.
She kisses him.
Sorry.
She grabs her coat and bag and runs out. Lights fade. Lights up on the house. Old George sits, staring at a plate with small pieces of toast. The doorbell rings. The doorbell rings a second time. Joy rushes on. She pulls on a jacket.
Mom, eat.
No.
She opens the door.
Anna? Hi, Mrs. Gallagher. Dr. Gallagher. Joy Gallagher. Come on in.
Anna steps in. She's a mosaic of hand-knitted color. She wears an elaborate headscarf and carries several handmade bags.
You're the nurse?
Yeah. Anna, nice to meet you.
Thanks for doing this on such short notice.
The lavender outside almost knocked me down. What a fragrance.
I know, right?
That's gorgeous. And so is this house. Are all these antiques?
Mostly. I'd give you the tour, but I'm running late.
Excuse me?
Mom, this is Anna. She's going to stay with you while I go to work.
Hi, Georgette.
George. She hates Georgette.
Hey, George. What did you mean, running late?
I have class. I wrote down her medications in the notebook on the table, and my cell phone number's in there, too. I'll keep it on vibrate during my classes.
Now, I don't think that
coffee's on. I don't know if you drink coffee, but I do, so there's plenty. And I should be home around 2 unless it's certain minute goes long.
Did you get the literature that we sent over?
Yes.
I'm here to meet with you, Mrs. Dr. Gallagher. Joy.
You're our nurse, right?
Yes, but
I told the receptionist. What's her name?
Sandy.
Sandy, right. I told Sandy everything over the phone, and she said you'd be at the house by 8 this morning.
Yes, but you and
I can't do that right now. I left everything in the notebook. It's very clear.
I don't think that you understand.
Mom, you haven't eaten anything.
I can't eat this.
Why not? It's just toast.
You put glass in it.
Don't be silly.
It's gritty. There's glass in it.
That's ridiculous.
You broke my red glass bottles, and now you're making me eat them.
Look, I'm sorry, but my dean, my boss, is sitting in on my class today. I have to be there. You and I can get acquainted when I come home this afternoon, okay?
It's more than getting acquainted.
Whatever.
Dr. Gallagher.
Joy. Call me Joy.
You know what I do, right?
You're a nurse.
A hospice nurse. what hospice is?
Of course I do.
Good. Now, before I can do anything for George, I need to sit down with you and get all the information, and together we can determine a plan of care.
There is no plan of care.
What do you mean?
There is no plan of care. Dr. Bramlett won't do any more chemo.
That's not what I mean. A hospice plan of care includes nursing and a variety of companion programs, massage, music therapy.
Sounds great, right, Mom? You love music.
And your mother's condition is terminal, yes.
And I can handle it, but I just can't take time off right now. I have to save it for when I just need someone to stay with her when I have to go to work.
I'm not a babysitter, Dr. Gallagher.
I never said that.
How about if we reschedule for a time when you're not so rushed?
I can't.
Well, I can't do anything until you sit down and talk to me.
Joy looks at her watch and sits.
You're right.
I'm sorry.
I need to apologize. The decision to begin hospice care is a difficult one. I know, but let's start over, okay? My name is Anna Nichols, and I'll be your mother's nurse and care coordinator for the next few months. Hi, George. How are you feeling today?
It's pretty.
I'm going to talk to Joy for a while, okay? I'm going to ask her some questions about you, but you feel free to talk to me too. Tell me anything that you like.
Mom, please eat something.
No.
Anna opens a bag and removes some files.
What kind of cancer does she have?
Lung cancer, adenocarcinoma.
How did it present?
Persistent pain in her hip.
So it's metastasized?
Yes.
What's her what's her prognosis?
18 to 24 months.
Is that what Dr. Bramlett told you?
Yes, 18 to 24 months with aggressive chemo.
But you're done with chemo.
We are. It was too much for her.
I have orders from Dr. Bramlett. She says that your mother has less time than that. Hospice generally won't be referred until life expectancy is 6 months or less.
She won't sit still for a scan.
Why not?
She can't. Chemotherapy-induced dementia. Everyone calls it chemo brain, but in my mom's case, that's an insult. She's paranoid and scared, terrified, really. The last time we tried a PET scan, the technicians had to tie her down, and she cried and screamed, so I stopped it. They tried their best, but couldn't get a clear reading, so we have no clue how long she has. She could have 3 months, she could have 3 years.
I see.
And I have no personal time or vacation time because my cushy professor job gives me summers off. Ha ha ha. So I can't take a leave of absence because it's unpaid, and I have to keep food on the table, so I need someone to help me during the day so I can go teach my classes without worrying that Mom's going to wander off or burn the house down.
I can definitely help you with that. It'll just take some time to schedule.
Joy's phone rings.
Sorry. Hi, Melissa. Yeah, I know. Can you call the dean's office and reschedule? Tell him I'm sick. I know. Ask Michael where the files are. Do you have his number? They're in there, too. Look, can I call you back? I'm in the middle of something. Okay, sorry.
What do you teach?
Philosophy.
Ah, I remember that class in college. Plato, Aristotle, Nietzsche.
Einstein. Newton, philosophy of space and time.
Oh, wow.
The dean is reviewing my class this morning.
You said. How's her pain?
We stay on top of it with Vicodin, but it doesn't seem to be helping as much anymore.
She probably needs something stronger.
Joy's phone rings again.
I'm sorry.
She silences it.
So, what's next?
I have some papers for you to sign and some literature to go over with you about hospice care.
Okay.
It'll take about an hour. How important is this review?
My job kind of depends on it.
Don't they understand that your mother is sick?
No, they don't.
That's bullshit!
I beg your pardon?
I'm sorry, but it's bullshit. I see this goddamn thing happen all the time and it pisses me off.
What?
This crap about family leave and personal time and FMLA, which is supposed to help, but it does nothing. Filling out forms to prove to some administrator that someone in your family is sick. We're social creatures and we need each other, for God's sakes. No, it's just nothing but time off, which is bullshit, because you work harder than you ever have before when a loved one is sick. bottom line and the almighty dollar and lose track of what's really important.
It's fine. I'll figure it out.
No, that's the problem. You shouldn't have to figure it out. I'm sorry. I kind of get on a soapbox sometimes. George, you and I are going to hang out for a while Joy goes to work, okay?
What?
We'll be fine. Go teach your class.
Really?
Yeah. We'll do the paperwork and consultation when you get home.
Oh my God, I promise I'll do all of that. You are amazing. A lifesaver.
Well, I do what I can.
Shit, that's not what I meant.
I know what you meant. I like Pinot Noir.
What?
Pinot Noir is my favorite. But in a pinch, I'll drink a good Shiraz.
I'll check in as soon as I get break.
Joy gathers her things next. Clock strikes. Anna looks at her watch. Another clock strikes. Anna smiles, removes her jacket, and hangs it up.
Your daughter's right, you know. You'll have to eat to keep up your strength.
She sits next to old George and removes her headscarf. Her head is completely bald. There is a small tattoo on the back of her head. Old George looks at Anna. Their eyes meet and Anna smiles. Old George tentatively raises her hand as though to touch Anna's bald head.
Go ahead, it's okay.
Old George touches Anna's head.
Oh, that tickles.
Old George puts her other hand on her own head.
That's right.
Light slowly fades. Joy lectures.
So, your readings for today were about entanglement. Einstein's spooky action at a distance. The quantum weirdness that you've all heard so much about. Here's basically how it works. You have a quarter. Heads and tails. Now slice that quarter down the middle, in effect turning it into two separate coins with two new heads and tails. With me so far? Okay, put one of the new coins in an envelope. Mail it to Alpha Centauri. Someone just like you, maybe with more bumps on his forehead and a tail, receives the package and opens it, removing his own unique coin half, while you still have yours. Two halves of the same original coin. Both you and your Alpha Centaurian counterpart flip the coin at the same time. Is it going to be heads or tails? The outcome is entirely random, correct? Your coin is tails. So is your friend's. Flip again. Heads. So is your friend's. Flip again. Heads. So is your friend's. In fact, with every single coin flip, the Alpha Centaurian coin will exhibit the exact same result as yours. Every single time. This is entanglement. Weird, huh?
Lights up on Joy's office. Joy and Michael enter.
How was that? Positive, comfortable, the positive, comfortable, non-confrontational environment conducive to learning?
Truthfully, not your best.
I know that, but did he look engaged?
I didn't want him to think I was staring.
At least he turned his phone off.
Did he? I thought I saw him texting.
You're kidding, right? Tell me you're kidding.
What did he say to you after class?
Very interesting, Dr. Gallagher.
That's it?
What if I baked him some brownies? Send them anonymously to his office?
Bribes don't work if they're anonymous.
Not bribe. They'd improve his overall outlook, which might imperceptibly affect the outcome of his review.
A bribe.
Are you surprised that I'd resort to such banal methods of persuasion?
I'm actually more surprised that you know how to bake.
I made the mistake of telling my mom in high school that anyone who can read can cook. She challenged me to a bake-off.
Who won?
She did, of course, hands down. But the judges were the other secretaries in the typing pool, so it could have been rigged.
What was the wager?
I had to cook dinner for a month.
That's one way to learn, I guess. Where's your mom now?
Beg your pardon?
You never mentioned her before. I was just curious.
I lost her a while ago.
Oh. Sorry.
Okay. Now, chapter 5.
Chapter 5?
It sucks.
Don't remind me.
The thread of the argument keeps jumping around. It's almost like you don't know what you're writing about.
I don't.
Well, why didn't you say something? Do you need more research?
No.
More time?
No, it's not that.
What is it?
I'm just not feeling it.
Huh?
It's just not happening.
Michael, you're not a jazz musician. I doubt the committee will appreciate me. I just wasn't feeling it. Defense. Like it or not, you're a superstar, my friend. Leagues above the other grad students. This is not superstar quality work.
Doesn't really seem fair.
So? We hold you to a much higher standard because you've earned it.
I've had other things on my mind.
Michael opens his bag. He pulls out a small gift and hands it to Joy.
What's this?
Open it.
Joy pulls off the ribbon and opens the box. Inside is a folded piece of paper.
Go on.
She opens the paper and reads.
Michael, what is this?
Sign.
Why?
Because.
But I thought you liked working with me.
I do.
Then why are you requesting a new committee chair?
Because I like working with you. I like you.
I don't understand.
You. It's all you, Joy. The amazingness of you. Your curiosity, your laugh, your body. And I just like you a lot. I like you a lot. It sounded so much better in my head.
What are you talking about?
I want to be with you, Joy. Go out on a real date in public, a couple. I want to hold your hand in front of other people. And I can't do it as long as I work for you. I can't do it as long as you're my committee chair. So I need you to sign this paper and resign from my committee so that Caldwell can take over and you and I can see where this goes.
But you called Caldwell a douche.
He is.
You're too good for him.
That's not the point.
But what about your dissertation?
What about it?
We've worked so hard. Don't you want to finish?
Sure.
Anything Caldwell can help you more than I can?
This has nothing to do with Caldwell, Joy.
But you want to work with him.
So I can be with you.
Don't you think we should have discussed this first?
I'm tired of fucking around in your office. I'm done with that.
You are?
Yes. I'm falling for you, and it won't be good for either of us if we're caught. And so here I am, making a choice, leaping into the abyss. Joy Gallagher, will you go out on an actual date with me? Dinner, and then maybe a ridiculous movie that has nothing to do with time dilation or length contraction.
Wow.
Wow as in wow we? Or wow shit?
Just so I'm clear, I can either work with you as your advisor or sleep with you. But not both.
When you put it that way, it sounds... Okay, you know what? Yeah, yes, yes.
You're giving me an ultimatum?
At first, this, whatever it is we're doing here, was exciting and cool, but now it's just stupid. I'm 34, for Christ's sake, and I'm sneaking around like a goddamn teenager. I'm better than that.
Well, thanks.
So are you. Don't you see? This is a good thing.
You can't just spring it on me like this.
I was trying to be romantic.
And I'm trying to digest the fact that you'd rather have sex with me than work with me.
God, no. Of course not. Jesus, Joy, you make it sound so...
What?
Insipid. It's not just sex. I'm choosing both. Your brain, your body. I'm choosing all of you. The whole Joy Gallagher package. Is that okay? And right now, frankly, I don't give a shit whether I finish the dissertation. I never saw myself as a professor, and there's not much else you can do with a PhD in philosophy. I only applied to grad school, what a bet.
What?
Becca Carlton called me out for being the only bartender without a graduate degree. They bet me that I couldn't get in, so I applied and I got in.
You know there's a waiting list for this program, right?
I started taking classes, and I loved them, and then I started working with you, and I loved... And now, well, here we are.
I don't get it. You're the best student we've had in a decade. Why didn't you tell me?
Because I didn't think it mattered. But now, I think maybe the reason I'm here is this. You. You okay?
Yes.
Too much?
Bit.
I felt like I was lying to you, Joy, and I'm done lying, okay?
He kisses her. She lets him.
What happens if I jump into the abyss with you?
I won't let you fall.
That's nice.
Unless it's for me.
Oh my god, seriously? What is this, a romance novel?
What? I thought you girls liked all that corny romantic shit. Ow! What's that for?
Being a pig.
She kisses him.
What was that for?
Being you.
Does that mean you go out with me?
Lights fade. Lights rise on the garden. Sunshine. Warmth. Young George enters. She wears serious gardening gear. A hat, gloves, clog. She brings a cushion for her knees. She kneels and starts to dig.
So what did you say? I was surprised. Totally taken aback. I mean, he's gorgeous, right? I'm sure I babbled like an idiot.
You never babbled, Joy. When you were two, you spoke in complete sentences.
But why? Why would he be interested in me?
That's the wrong question, Joy. It's not why. It's why not? Why not? So how did he ask you?
He stopped me in the hallway. I was late for calculus.
And
he said, I think we should go to prom.
And
I turned around because I thought he was talking to someone else.
Oh, no. What did you say?
At first I said, me? And then he said, yeah. And then I said, why?
You did.
I did. Why would he even think that I'd be interested in going to prom?
Because you're beautiful and smart.
I'm a geek, Mom. And I don't use half a can of Aquanet on my hair every morning like the other girls. Oh, and did you hear that Melinda Duffy's hair caught on fire in chemistry? She got too close to a Bunsen burner.
I think you should go.
What?
To prom. You should go.
I told you I hate that stuff.
You're 17. How many boyfriends have you had?
Two?
Right. For how long?
2 weeks.
Total. And that one punk kid with the safety pins, what was his name?
Mark.
Right.
With a C.
Right. When Mark with a C broke it off with you.
Over the phone. Who the hell does that?
When he broke it off with you, you went for a walk for 2 hours.
So?
In the pouring rain.
Froze my ass off.
Of course you did. Why did you do that?
I loved him.
Bullshit, Joy. He was an idiot.
All right, he was an idiot.
And you were being dramatic. Why can't you just accept that you deserve better and you deserve to have fun?
Guys aren't exactly lining up at the door.
Apparently they are.
Trust me, if I go, as soon as we get to dinner, I'll open my mouth and say something obtuse, and he'll realize what a big mistake he made asking me to prom. I'm not prom material.
Bullshit.
And it hurt when Mark dumped me. It hurt. Bad.
Of course it did.
I don't want to hurt like that again.
You're going to.
Well, that's helpful, Mom. Thanks.
I'm not going to lie to you. You're so intense, Joy. You feel everything so deeply. I worry about you.
Why?
Because life is hard. And you can't be so serious all the time or you'll be miserable. And what is the point of that, really? We're here for such a short time. I want you to be happy. Do something silly. And wear bright colors once in a while.
Black suits me.
You only think it does.
You really want me to go to prom?
You'll regret it if you don't. It's ridiculous and stupid, yes. But we need ridiculous and stupid. Just like we need Shakespeare and... what's the name of that club?
What club?
The one that meets on Mondays.
Ah, future problem solvers.
Right. We need future problem solvers, and we need prom. We need both.
High school sucks.
It won't be long now.
It especially sucks when you get straight A's and your teachers think you walk on water.
I know, honey.
And everyone hates you even more, so Adrian Jennings shoves you in a locker.
Yeah, well, Adrian Jennings is just a bitch. I promise you, Joy, when you get to college, when you get out of prison next year, you're going to shine. You are going to do amazing and wonderful things, and I'm already so proud of you.
Jesus, Mom, no pressure.
It's all in front of you.
I haven't done anything yet.
You I raise you to be independent.
I'm not a feminist, but I'll raise you to be one.
Did it work?
What do you think?
Well, it wasn't easy. Trust me.
In the background, old George enters. She wanders around, agitated. She tugs at her collar.
So tight!
I love you, Mom.
Of course you do. I'm awesome. Now, help me aerate the lavender.
What do I do?
Take this rake, make little holes all over the bed like this.
Why are we doing this?
To mix oxygen with the soil so it'll grow bigger.
It already covers the whole front of the house.
It can be bigger.
Go big or go home, huh?
They dig. Old George starts singing under her breath. Still in the background, she removes her pants and shirt.
I love this garden. There is nothing like digging in the dirt to remind you of where you come from. It's so simple, basic. Just you, the earth, the smell, loam, clay.
You know, in my calculus class, we're learning about fractal geometry. The shapes are like works of art, only in nature, and they're found everywhere, especially in the microscopic view of plant life.
Joy.
What?
Dig.
They dig. Old George sings a little louder. She's in her underwear.
When the Lord is in the seventh house.
Time for the bone meal.
What?
Organic fertilizer.
I thought you said bone meal.
I did.
Bone meal?
And blood meal. It's the best way to increase the nitrogen in the soil.
As in ground up bones?
And blood. They love it.
That's macabre.
It's just life, Joy. All living things owe their existence to other living things. That's how it works. Now keep making those little holes. I'll be right back.
Young George exits. Old George, in her underwear, runs forward singing.
When the moon is in the seventh house,
Mom,
and Jupiter aligns with Mars, and peace will guide the planets.
She removes her bra and spins like a child.
Mom, stop it!
We'll steer the stars. Oh, sing with me, Joy! This is the dawning of the Hi, Mrs. Peterson!
Joy picks up the blanket and chases down her mother. She covers her. Old George fights her.
You're choking me! Where's Anna?
It's Saturday. She's not coming today.
I want Anna!
Mom!
Anna, where are you? Anna, let me out. Let me out. Why won't you let me out?
Mom, stop! Do you hear me?
Who are you?
It's me, Mom. It's Joy.
Who?
Let's go inside.
Joy holds the blanket around her mother as the lights fade. Joy lectures.
Einstein was passionately in favor of a local universe. In a local universe, cause and effect make sense. Space and time, he said, still needs to be traversed in order for any kind of cause and effect to occur. So entanglement drove him crazy. Spooky action at a distance. It's ironic, really. Einstein resisted quantum mechanics because it defied his intuition. Relativity, his biggest discovery, also defies our intuition, but that's only because the world's too slow. When we all travel at the speed of light, relativity makes complete sense. Quantum mechanics, however, is a tricky bastard. It cannot be grasped by any kind of logic because it literally defies reality. It's the ultimate rebel. And as stubborn and bizarre as it is, we know it to be true because the data supports it time and time again. Experimental data proves that quantum mechanics works despite its voodoo qualities, and Einstein hated that. The fact that we can't predict nature is woven into the very fabric of nature. The actual question that we cannot answer, then, is the answer.
Lights fade. Lights rise on the house. Joy types on a laptop. Anna knits. Old George sits and stares.
What are you working on?
Essay questions. Midterm.
I remember blue books when I was in college. Do you still use blue books?
Some do. Most everything's electronic now.
A clock strikes two.
Makes sense, you know.
What?
You grew up in a house full of clocks. You teach about time. Until you put that together.
The clocks were just things to me. Time is something else, something bigger.
It's clever of her to set them off by a few minutes. That way she can hear every chime.
Drives me crazy. Noon lasts half an hour in this house.
How many clocks does she have?
Seven. Not counting the clocks that are parts of other things.
Like that belly of the Buddha in the bedroom? Are they all antiques?
Not all of them. There's a clock in the basement that she had made out of an old dartboard I brought home from England.
Oh, right. You were a Rhodes Scholar. I Googled you after the first day.
Yeah, I'm sorry about that.
Sorry about what?
The way I treated you. I was trying to... I don't know.
That was nothing. I've broken up fist fights before on the first day.
Really?
You'd be surprised.
Anna looks around the room.
She has so much beautiful stuff.
And she knows every piece of it. Every antique, every clock, every book, dish, picture on the wall.
Wow.
She was an army brat growing up. She moved all the time, base to base, Paris, Germany, California, Japan. By the time she was 16, she spoke 4 languages. Whenever she moved, she had to get rid of everything she owned. It was too expensive to ship stuff, so every 2 or 3 years, she started over with nothing but a trunk of clothes. When she finally got her own place, she decided that she wanted things. Lots of things. All around her. Meaningful things. Things with history.
I like that.
But none of this is her history.
Or someone's history.
Another clock strikes 2. Anna looks at her watch and crosses to old George.
George, honey. It's time for your pain medication, okay? I'll be right back. Don't go anywhere.
Anna smiles and exits. Joy rises and slowly crosses to her mother.
Mom? Mom? Are you there?
What are you doing here?
She slaps Joy.
Mom!
Another slap.
Mom!
Go away. You can't do it anymore.
Young George rushes out.
Joy, what is it? It hurts, Mommy. It hurts so bad.
I know, but I can't help you until you tell me what's wrong.
It hurts all over. I fell.
How did you fall?
Off my bike. Fell off my bike. I'm sorry.
It's okay. Joy, let me see. Oh, wow. Those are some big scrapes, kiddo. What were you doing?
What were you doing?
I wanted to see how fast I could go.
On your bike?
Yeah. I wanted to go faster and faster and faster so much.
You stood up on the pedals, didn't you?
Yes.
After I told you not to do that.
Sorry, Mommy. I'm so sorry.
Well, this is exactly why I told you not to do that. You have to be careful.
But I wanted to go fast.
It's a little bike, honey. It can only go so fast. Too much and it gets out of control.
But it felt so good. The wind was in my hair. And then I hit a big rock and I flew.
For real. For a minute, I flew.
And then you landed on your knee.
It hurts.
It's okay. Let me see.
Young George examines Joy's knee.
Well, I don't think it's broken.
I'm sorry, Mommy.
Let me get some peroxide and we'll wash it out. It'll sting pretty badly, but it'll feel better.
Promise?
Promise.
Young George exits. Anna enters with a syringe.
Just a little pinch and it's gonna sting going in. Then you'll feel better, I promise. Hey, is everything okay?
Fine. Anna opens an alcohol wipe and prepares old George's arm. She administers the injection.
It hurts.
I know. Shh. I hate giving her these injections, but I don't want her changing an IV yet. She's still pretty mobile. Here you go, sweetie.
Anna strokes old George's hair for a moment, then exits. Young George enters with a pack of cigarettes. She lights up and inhales deeply.
What are you doing?
Oh, shit. What are you doing here?
I live here.
What the hell, Mom?
It's just one.
You quit. 2 months ago, you quit.
I've had a bad day, Joy. I
don't
You mean quit! You told me you quit! You lied to me!
I'm tired of you taping pictures of diseased lungs to the bathroom mirror. I'm tired of your holier-than-thou crap. I like smoking, okay? I like it. Tastes good. It makes me feel good.
And it'll kill you.
You don't know that.
Every day in health class, they drill it into my skull. Smoking kills you. It coats your lungs with tar. It crystallizes and causes tumors.
There's no proof.
And then I come home and watch you light up 20 times a day.
Oh, for God's sakes, Joy, get off your high horse. Everybody smokes.
Joy takes her cigarette and crushes it. She does the same to the whole pack.
You're the only family I have. Doesn't that mean anything to you?
Don't you dare. Don't you dare make me feel guilty, Joy Gallagher. I raised you by myself, a single mother shunned by everyone. I gave up everything for you, and you have no right to tell me what to do.
Young George exits. Anna enters, crossing to George. She listens to her heart with a stethoscope.
I'm so sorry.
She'll stop moaning once the morphine kicks in.
I have other things to do. I've got this. I can stay with her.
I'm good.
And don't you have other patients?
Nope. Just your mom. I'm easing in after some time off.
Vacation?
Chemotherapy.
Oh my God. I'm sorry.
Why? We caught it early and they operated, chopped off my left hip, and then I told them to take the other one. Chemotherapy was just a in case. I'm fine.
That's good.
When I found out, I was confused. I mean, I'm a nurse, right? I knew what to do. I ate well, I exercised, I breastfed both my daughters, which is supposed to be like the best thing you can do. I took vitamins and antioxidants, but not too many. Everything in moderation, right? Nobody in my family had cancer. Heart disease was our plague. Talk about random.
That explains the
hair or lack thereof. I shaved it off the moment I was diagnosed. My doc said that my hair might not even fall out, but to tell you the truth, it was liberating.
And the tattoo?
I was having a day. I wanted to do something crazy. And I decided, what the hell? If I don't like it, my hair will grow back and I won't have to look at it. Hurt like a mama. Tell you. My girls thought I went off the deep end, but they're teenagers. Everything annoys them.
Do you like it?
I keep shaving my head, so I guess I do.
What does it mean?
It's a Celtic triple spiral. Maiden, mother, crone. It stands for power through transition and growth. Seems appropriate, don't you think?
I don't know much about spirituality.
But you teach about space and time.
Science.
Sounds pretty spiritual to me.
How do you do it?
Do what?
Work with people who are dying.
It's my job. Just like teaching is your job.
But yeah, but you spend day after day with such decay. Cancer is just evil.
No, it's not.
How can you say that?
I see this billboard on my way here every day. A row of doctors standing up tall, looking fierce, arms crossed, determined. The caption says, "Watch out, cancer! The reinforcements are here!" Like it's a goddamn war. And these doctors are like generals, or out to conquer and colonize the human body so we'll never get sick. We'll never die.
But it is a war.
That's a myth. Black and white story of good versus evil that we can wrap our brains around. Cancer isn't some invader. It's us. Your mom. Me. Our own DNA run amok. It divides and divides and divides and grows and refuses to die despite all the poison that we throw at it. It's our shadow self. Our rebellious self. The most resilient self. The self that refuses to quit. When we poison cancer, we're poisoning ourselves.
So what are you saying? We shouldn't treat it? We shouldn't ignore it?
Good Lord, no. We should throw everything we have at it. But it's ironic, right? In order to live, we have to kill off the cells that don't know how to die. Do you know how to knit?
Beg pardon?
Non sequitur, I know. But I'm curious. Have you ever learned to knit?
No.
You should.
Why?
You'd be good at it.
How do you know?
You're fidgety. Like me.
Anna opens her bag. She pulls out a colorful pile of yarn.
I have this ritual. Whenever I take on a new patient, I start a new project, and I work on it every visit. Doesn't matter what it is. I knit all kinds of things, skirts, sweaters, scarves, blankets. I sit with the patient, and I talk with them, and I knit. It's like I'm weaving them into whatever I'm working on. Their spirit, their breath becomes a part of the fabric. The questions they ask, the strange phrases they mumble, the silence. It's all here. This skirt, an 84-year-old man named Richard Seltzer. He lied about his age and joined the army when he was 15. Fought in World War II and Korea. His wife died 10 years before he did. They tried to have kids, but they couldn't, so it was just Richard and me for 4 months. We stayed in his home, and I learned all about his trips to Jerusalem and Egypt. The Great Pyramids and the Sphinx. And when it got close to the end, he started talking to his wife, Betty, like she was in a room. He wanted to be certain that she wasn't jealous of me. He made me laugh a lot. This vest is Mabel Davis. She was in a coma for the entire time I was with her, so I never heard her speak, but she had a huge family. And they were all by her side every day. I wet her lips and listened to them tell stories to her and about her. They argued with each other over silly shit, and then they'd make up and they'd talk more and cry. Oh, her youngest daughter crawled into bed with her and put her arms around her and held her for hours. She was holding her like that the moment she died. This is your mother.
What is it?
I don't know yet. What do you think it should be?
She opens her bag and pulls out two needles and a skein of yarn.
These are for you. What? You're going to learn how to knit.
Anna starts casting stitches onto Joy's needle.
Oh, no, no, you don't have to do
that. Why not?
I have too much work to do.
So, it's Friday afternoon, it'll keep.
No.
Sit.
Joy remains.
People make a big deal about how complicated this is, but it really isn't. Basically, all you do is you take your needle and make loops, and you pull them through each other. Take a single strand of yarn, and you loop it over itself until it turns into fabric. See? Loop passes through loop, passes through loop. You have a loop on your left needle, you make a loop on the right one, and you pass it through. Now I've cast on 10 stitches for you. Watch. Slip your right needle through the front of the loop like this. You wrap the yarn around, pull it through. See? The stitch moves from the left to the right. Put your needle through the loop, wrap it around, pull it through. Now you try.
I can't.
Sure you can.
I'm warning you, I'm extremely clumsy.
So?
I'll make a mess of your yarn.
This is the good stuff. Believe me, you will know when you're knitting with the good stuff. It's like fingers are having multiple orgasms.
What?
Sit!
Joy remains standing.
It is useless to resist me. I will win in the end.
Joy finally sits. Anna gives her a needle.
Is this wood?
Bamboo. I only knit with bamboo. It's warm and quiet and entirely sustainable. Through the back. Now loop the working yarn over the right needle just like that, and now pull it through. No, 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 the other way, and slide it off. Good, you did it!
I did?
Again!
A pause. Just join it. She loses a stitch.
Oh, shit. No big deal. You can just pick it up like this, and again, like this.
Joy watches.
What did she say?
In through the front. Once when I peek through the window, I'll jump straight.
My grandmother used to say that.
In through the front door, once around the back, peek through the window, and off jumps Jack.
Is it about knitting?
It's a rhyme to help you to remember what to do.
In through the front door, once around the back, peek through the window, and off jumps Jack.
See?
In through the front door, once around the back, peek through the window, and off jumps Jack.
Like that?
Just like that. Does George know how to knit?
Maybe. I don't think so.
Hey, George, do you know how to knit?
What happens when I get to the end of the row?
Just turn your needle around and do it again. Make another row. And so on and so on and so on.
That's easy.
Isn't it?
In through the front door, once around the back.
Poop out the window, and then shits Jack.
What did you say, George?
I said shit. Old Jack shits.
What's that smell?
Mom?
Shit, 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 shit.
George, honey, are you okay?
No! Shit, 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 I'm not okay. I'm fucking falling apart.
Mom, what did you do?
It's all right.
No.
I'm shitting my pants, it won't stop. Running down my leg, all over the chair, and look at that, it's everywhere.
Some help here, please.
No! You keep her away from me!
What?
It's okay, sweetie, just let it come, you're fine.
Can't you get her to the bathroom?
Who are you yelling at me?
I'm not yelling at you.
What's wrong? What did I do?
Nothing, honey, it's okay. Grab a towel, anything.
I don't know who she is. She can't help me, I need you, and only you can help me.
Why is this happening to her?
It's perfectly natural. There's a box of diapers in my car.
Diapers?
Yes.
I can't do this.
What did I do wrong?
Nothing.
I can't.
I'll give her away from me, she hates me.
I don't hate you.
Yes, you do, I can see it in your eyes when you look at me.
You hate me.
I don't hate you.
Stop hating me.
Yes.
You stay away from me.
You're not my mother. You are not my mother.
Pull yourself together, Joy.
I don't know who you are. Why don't you just leave me alone? It's time for you to die. Die. Just die, you filthy witch. Leave me alone.
Stop it right now. You will go to my car and you will get a box of diapers out of the trunk and you will bring them to me and then you will help me clean up your mother.
No.
This is not a choice, Joy. This is what we do. For her. For your mother.
She's not my mother. My mother died months ago.
Anna and old George exit the bathroom.
Front door, once around the back. Wipe it on my fingers and poof up the back.
Young George enters and sits at the makeup table. She picks up her bottle of perfume.
Special occasions only, right, sweetheart?
She sprays the air, steps into the mist, and twirls.
Share the fantasy. Sweetheart? What's wrong, Joy? Joy!
Joy exits. A final clock strikes two. Blackout. End of Act One.
Thank you. lecture light. Secrets keep us searching. They're the engine of science. Secrets keep us engaged. They whisper to us from behind the veil, come and see. We think we're so smart, but the fact is we've only just scratched the surface. Entanglement shows us that reality itself is infinitely more bizarre than anything we could imagine, so we keep looking. We keep listening to those weird whispers, wondering what they're really saying.
Furious typing at a crazy speed, lights rise, revealing young George, smoking, sitting at a massive typewriter, an IBM Selectric 3. Her fingers fly. Joy hovers.
Come on, why not?
Because I said so.
But that's no reason.
It's reason enough for me, now scoot.
More typing.
At least tell me what it's about.
Boy meets girl. Boy falls in love with girl. And they live happily ever after.
When do they do the nasty?
Joy!
Make the beast with two backs.
What?
That's Shakespeare.
I know.
Let me read it.
No!
You secretly want me to read it.
Oh, yeah?
Otherwise, why would you be typing so brazenly in front of me, tempting me with all of your typing?
Because I work during the day and this is the only time I have to write. Shouldn't you be doing homework or something?
I'm finished.
Don't you have friends to talk to on the phone for hours?
Hello, have you met me? Joy Gallagher, and I have no normal teenage life.
You can't read it until I'm finished. And I won't be finished for a long, long, long time. Maybe by the time you're 21.
But I can help you. I can help you proofread,
Joy,
and edit.
Stop. I am doing this for me, okay? Not for you. For me. I want to do this myself. Besides, it's just a silly romance novel. It's one of those stupid paperbacks, a dime a dozen. I've read so many of them, I thought I might have a knack for it.
Maybe we'll be rich or something.
Maybe.
All the more reason to let me read it.
No.
Why not?
Because I'm embarrassed, all right? It's embarrassing. There are things in here my 14-year-old daughter has no business reading.
I sneak those books out of your nightstand, you know.
What?
You have at least 30 romance books stacked up in the bottom of your nightstand. I sneak into your room and take them when you're at work. I flip through them and read the dirty parts.
Sure.
What? Am I in trouble?
I don't know. Maybe. I don't know. Really, you do that? Why?
At first, I was just curious. I wanted to know what you found so interesting in them. And then, well, I have to learn about that stuff somehow, right?
Oh, you can ask me.
You taught me everything I need to know about sex, Mom. I'm good with the technical stuff, but there's other stuff, too.
What kind of stuff?
You know, kissing, feelings. What to do, I guess? I don't know, I'm sorry I brought it up.
Joy, these books aren't real. They aren't even close to real life. They're just fantasies written for lonely women.
You're not lonely. Are you?
It's bluff, Joy, it's cheap thrills. I'll let you read this when you're older.
Okay.
I promise. Right now, it's just... Well, I'm sure it's just terrible. I still can't believe that you snuck around behind my back like that.
Those books are totally tame compared to the ones that get passed around the cafeteria at lunch. Last week, Veronica Baird snuck in a copy of The Happy Hooker.
What?
More tea?
Thanks.
Joy pours her mother more iced tea. Typing resumes.
I need a synonym for heaving.
Heaving. Throwing? Lurching? Flinging?
Flinging breasts. Heaving it is. Such a cliche.
Hey, Mom. I'm proud of you.
What for?
For writing your book.
Oh, I told you, it's just a silly...
I don't care. You did it. It's yours. That's really the only reason I want to read it.
Go away. I'm busy.
She types. Old George enters. She shuffles through the room, muttering, her voice fading in and out of the sound of typing.
That's taxes. Dad's taxes. Where are Dad's taxes? I have to find Dad's taxes. Where are they? I have to have given them to her. I have to give them to her. But now I've lost them. I don't know where Dad's taxes are. Excuse me. Have you seen Dad's taxes?
No, I haven't. I'm sorry.
I have to find them before it gets too late, or she'll never forgive me. Dad's taxes. Dad's taxes. Where the hell did I put Dad's taxes? It has to be somewhere. Dad's taxes. Dad's taxes. Anna! Did you? I still need to find Dad's taxes. Have you found them yet?
Old George continues to look around the room. Anna enters.
You're back.
Yes. I'm sorry. Thank you for staying. Where did you sleep?
In her room, with her.
What's she saying?
Dad's taxes. She's been repeating it all morning. Do you have any idea what that means?
Not a clue.
She's looking for something.
My grandfather was incredibly disorganized. I have a hard time believing that he even kept his tax returns.
Well, she really wants to find whatever it is.
When he died, my grandfather, he spent his last 2 weeks in a nursing home. We went to see him every day, stayed with him in a kind of vigil, and the atmosphere was so indescribably bleak. Urine and disinfectant. The hallway clogged with old men and women wandering. Vacant stares.
I don't want to die like this, Joy.
She made me promise.
Please, don't let this happen to me, Joy, okay? I want to die with dignity.
So I promised.
I don't want to waste away in some home, mumbling gibberish.
Young George crosses and puts a record on.
I promised her that I would make sure that she left this world as the same strong, sassy woman she always was, and that she wouldn't be alone. I never should have made that promise.
Why?
Because she is alone. She's completely alone. Look at her. She doesn't know who I am. I don't understand what she says, what she wants. I've tried to reach her, but nothing works. We were supposed to have time. But I was robbed, Anna. I was fucking robbed. She's only 63, so Dr. Bramlett thought we should be aggressive with her treatment. She was strong, and she wanted as much time as she could get. So we fought. She fought as hard as she could, just like she was supposed to. Cisplatin and etoposide, then carboplatin, which is platinum, I found out. Liquid platinum pumped straight into your blood. And then 2 months later, 2 months, she started forgetting things. Little things first, then big things, then me. She was scared, so scared, and I tried to help her, but I couldn't because she didn't understand. I don't know what this is, but it certainly isn't dignity.
Dignity is my job, Joy. That's what I'm here for. Joy finds a photo album and opens it.
This is my favorite photograph. All four women in our family.
It's beautiful.
My great-grandmother, my grandmother, my mom, and me. My great-grandmother's 50th anniversary party. There was a professional photographer there, but this is just a snapshot. I have no idea who took it. We aren't looking at the camera, we're looking off to the right or at something or someone, and we're laughing. And she's so beautiful and alive. She's in the middle of saying something. What is it? What's she saying? This is my mom, and I have to know what she's saying.
This is a photograph, Joy.
Can you tell me what she's saying, Anna? I have to know.
Lights fade. Joy lectures.
Google the term quantum jumping. What's the first hit? Quantum jumping, the interdimensional quest for a better you. Now, if you take the time to watch some of these videos, and I totally don't recommend it, you'll learn how to jump from one potential you to another more creative and ambitious you through meditation and, of course, The purchase of a DVD master course in the technique for only a mere $99.95 plus shipping and handling. Think about it. Honestly, who wouldn't want to master transitioning from one world where everything sucks to another where everything is awesome? It's a very enticing prospect. And it's based in science, right? Bullshit. We cannot simply accept the beauty and the unfathomable qualities of nature. Oh no, we have to control them and make a buck if we can. And people fall for it all the time, over and over again, and they go to conferences and seminars and pay ridiculous amounts of money to strange gurus who say they can jump into alternate universes or cleanse your souls from the microscopic aliens that live within. Why? I have a theory. The only way we can accept the vastness of the universe, the only way we can hope to wrap our tiny little brains around it, is to reduce it to a commodity, to control it, to put our tiny, insignificant selves in the center so that we are its masters. We want so badly to control the universe that we're willing to cut it off at the knees, to make it seem stupid and cheap and tawdry. Why do we do that?
Light's faith. Lights rise on Joy's office. She sits at her desk and begins to type on her laptop. After a moment, she stops. She opens her briefcase and removes her knitting. Her project is several rows long, fairly sloppy, but she seems to be getting the hang of it.
Move through the front door, once around the back, peek through the window, and off jumps Jack.
Michael enters.
I got your message. What's the emergency?
Have you ever looked, I mean really looked, at the structure of knitting?
I can't say that I have.
It's amazing, really. Loop, passing through loop, passing through loop, and it's all just one strand of yarn. Look at this!
Joy, what's the emergency? Your message didn't make any sense.
I mean, who sat down and really took the time to figure out how to do this?
I thought you weren't in this afternoon.
I'm not, but I couldn't stop thinking about Chapter 4.
Chapter 4? My Chapter 4?
Entropy.
How is that an emergency?
Your argument is that the old idea of order to disorder is antiquated, right? That what we think of as disorder is actually a universe waking up to its infinite possibilities.
Right?
That's beautiful, but it's a lie.
What?
Things fall apart. The center cannot hold. A system reaches its pinnacle of beauty only to remain there for not even a fraction of a second, and then it begins to decompose to nothing. Movement through time means death.
What about the degree of freedom of states of higher entropy?
Degree of freedom, what does that even mean?
It's statistical mechanics.
Take my mother, for instance.
Your mother?
She's dying. Lung cancer. It can't be treated. No radiation, no surgery, and the chemo already killed her mind. She's delusional. We're just waiting for the body to die.
What?
So in your argument, her delusional state is actually the more desirable state as it represents a more diverse and unpredictable system.
Joy!
Than when she was in her physical prime, and the system was more contained and predictable. So in your argument, when she shits her pants, it's simply a higher degree of freedom.
Joy, stop!
What?
You told me your mother was already dead.
No, I didn't.
You said you'd lost her.
I did. I have lost her.
But, I mean, how are you doing? Are you okay?
No, I'm not okay.
Why didn't you tell me?
Because I needed you not to know.
What do you mean?
You were my safe haven, Michael. But now you're suggesting that the unpredictability of disorder is what a closed system should aspire to, right?
Stop this.
So really, what does it matter?
Talk to me.
She kisses him hard. He stops her.
Well, what's this?
She kisses him again. He resists.
Joy, joy!
What?
Stop!
No.
We're not doing this.
Kiss me or I'll scream.
Very funny.
You think I'm being funny? I'll scream, goddamn you!
Shh.
I'll scream and then I'll fucking fail you! Do you hear me?
What?
I won't let you take the one thing in my life that makes sense. Jesus, Michael! Why did you have to fall in love with me? This is my world. I close the door and everything else goes away and there's no pressure to do or be anyone, anything, to anyone. Here it doesn't stink or hurt, and it's not decomposing or disappearing in front of me or shitting itself, and I don't have to worry about losing you because it's just not that important. The doors are closed. I'm not terrified of what you're going to do or what you're going to say, and it fucking makes sense because I know who we are.
Joy, calm down.
Shut up! Shut up! Shut up! You think that I need you? I don't. I mean, you came here on some goddamn bet, right? Because you thought it would be fun to make a fucking mockery of my entire career, cheapening everything I've worked for, just to show off to a bunch of drunks in some bar who can't pull their heads out of their asses long enough to do something productive with their lives. Well, you know what? You can't. I'm in control here. You're the student, and I am the teacher. You have to do what I say because I know what's best. I always know what's best, and I'm always right. And if you question me, if you question anything, then you won't pass. And that's no skin off my back. You want to know why? Because you're nothing special. Do you hear me? There are 20 other wannabes exactly like you, waiting in line behind you, dying to get into this place, dying to study with me. If you fail, and you will fail, because you're nothing special.
Joy roots around on her desk. She finds the box with the paper inside. She unfolds it and signs it.
Give my regards to Caldwell.
Michael takes the key off of his ring, tosses it onto the desk, and exits. Lights fade. Joy lectures.
When particles are not being observed or interacting with the environment, they have a nebulous, fuzzy existence characterized solely by the probability that one or another potentiality might be realized. Reality itself, then, is a hazy web of what? Information. In entanglement, remember that one particle is here and one is over there, and they instantaneously exhibit the same behavior. No time, no vehicle of communication. Information is neither matter nor energy. It needs matter for embodiment and energy to do its bidding, but information itself is completely abstract. Think about that for too long, and soon you'll realize that the moon itself doesn't really exist unless you're looking at it.
Lights shift. Young George is on the phone, ringing. Joy picks up.
Hello?
Joy? Oh my God, Joy, is that you?
Who is this?
Joy, it's me.
Mom, is that you?
Oh, Jesus, God, Jesus, thank you. Hi, honey, it's so good to hear your voice.
How on earth did you find me?
It wasn't easy, believe me.
What?
I said it wasn't easy. I've been calling youth hostels all night.
Are you okay?
The rector in Oxford said you were somewhere in the Highlands. I didn't know what else to do. Where the hell is Oban?
What?
Where's Oban?
West coast of Scotland.
Oh. Wow. Is it pretty? I bet it's pretty. What time is it there?
A little after 7.
It's 1 in the morning here.
I know that. Mom, what's wrong? Are you okay? Are you there?
It's Grandma, honey.
What happened?
She, oh, Jesus, Joy, she died. Grandma died last night. A stroke. I've been trying to find you for hours. Are you there?
Yeah, Mom, I'm here.
I was getting ready for bed, and I was watching the news, and she called me. She wasn't making any sense. She was speaking gibberish. So I called 911, and they told me to meet them at the hospital, and then they brought her in, but it was too late, and I... Oh, God, oh, honey.
What are you doing now?
Talking to you.
No, I mean, is anybody with you?
No, I'm fine.
Call Linda. Have her come over and stay with you until I get there.
What?
As soon as I get off the phone with you, I'm calling someone. I don't know. I'll figure it out. I'm sure I can get a flight out of Edinburgh, but I don't know when it'll be.
No.
In the meantime, call Linda or Phyllis to come and stay with you.
I said no.
What do you mean, no?
No. You're not coming home.
Don't be ridiculous.
You've only been there for 2 months, Joy. You're not coming home.
Of course I'm coming home.
Your stipend won't cover your ticket, and we can't afford to send you back. If you come home now, that is it. You're giving it all up.
So? Who cares?
Joy, listen to me. Grandma is gone. You coming home isn't going to change that. She was so ridiculously proud of you, honey. You are the first person in our family to go to college. And you're at Oxford, for God's sakes. A Rhodes Scholar, the best of the best. If she were here, she'd tell you to stay. She'd insist on it.
What about you?
What about me?
Who's going to take care of you?
I don't need anyone to take care of me, Joy.
Mom!
I'm calling Uncle Bob in the morning, and my cousins will come in from Ohio, all 6 of them. Jesus, won't that be fun? And like you said, I've got Linda and Phyllis.
This isn't right.
There'll be too many people here, and there's a ton of arrangements to make.
I should be there.
You should be right where you are. You've worked your entire life to earn this opportunity, and I won't have you throw it away on my account.
I'm not throwing it away.
Is it pretty there?
Yes.
Are you traveling alone?
I'm with Andrew and Paul.
Oh, those two Australians you wrote me about.
Yes.
On Walkabout, right? Isn't that great? Walkabout?
Sure.
Are you being careful?
Mom.
Have them take you out for a pint. Or seven. Tell everyone in the bar stories. About us.
The club.
Right. You can celebrate her that way, okay? A huge Scottish wake. She'd love that. I mailed you another letter yesterday. I put some sprigs of lavender in that envelope. You should see it this year. It's massive.
Can you send me a picture?
You bet.
I'll call you when I get back to campus.
You better. How long?
A week. I love you, Mom.
Love you too, baby.
I'm sorry.
For what?
Lights fade. Lights up on the empty house. Joy enters with her briefcase.
Mom? Mom, I'm home. Anna? Are you guys outside? You should be. It's beautiful out there. Where is everybody? What's going on? What's so funny?
Lights rise on the garden. Anna and old George are laughing and digging. They're both covered with mud from head to toe.
What's going on out here?
We're gardening. We're digging. Look at me.
Your mom is working in her garden.
Oh, I've missed it so much.
Isn't she beautiful? Come and join us, Joy.
What did you do to the lavender? All of her lavender. It's gone. You dug it up?
She wanted to...
So you let her destroy it? What the hell's the matter with you?
Why are you always yelling?
Mom, get out of there.
Too much! Too loud!
You're a mess! We came out here because it was such a lovely day, and we started digging over there, and she was so happy, and we were laughing, and so we just kept digging, and before I knew it,
there's nothing left! It covered the front of the house, and now there's nothing!
Stop yelling!
I'm sorry.
How could you? You promised me, Anna. You promised dignity. Look at her. She's filthy. And her lavender is gone. All of it. She worked for years on it. It's ruined. What am I supposed to do
now? Don't you yell at her!
Mom, stop it. Both of you, stop.
Old George lunges at her daughter. They struggle. Anna tries to pull them apart.
Help me, Anna! Don't let her kill me!
Joy pushes George off of her. George stumbles and falls.
Oh my God.
Call 911, but do it!
Joy runs into the house. Old George howls and cries, and life fades. Joy lectures.
So if you had a time machine, where would you go? What would you change? Could you change things? For the better?
Old George's voice in the darkness.
But my hip hurts.
I know, Mom. Did you go to the doctor like I told you to? The many worlds interpretation is just one way we can think about it. The act of traveling back in time locks us out of those worlds where time travel isn't possible, and then...
He sent me to physical therapy.
Are you doing your exercises?
I can't. It hurts.
Well, of course it hurts. It's physical therapy. It's supposed to hurt. Il faut souffrir pour être belle.
What?
Right?
What?
So when we think about the staggering implications of multiple parallel universes, we begin to realize that the timeline, which we picture as extending into infinity from, say, right to left, might also extend up and down, infinite dimensions, stacked on top of each other.
I'm just so sad, Joy.
What do you mean?
I'm just in such a dark place.
A dark place? What are you talking about? Mom?
Nothing. I'm fine, honey. I'm sure it's just the pain.
Tell you what, let's go shopping on Saturday. You and me time, okay?
Gotta go now.
Mom? Mom, are you there? So, what does this mean for us now, in the present? Should we even consider those choices we made that diverted the timeline irrevocably into a future that we didn't even want? That we didn't even think about the consequences that... I'm sorry. Can't do this. Not today. Go home. Class dismissed.
She walks out of her lecture light. It slowly fades. Lights rise on Joy at home. She knits. After a moment, Anna enters.
You're getting pretty good at that.
Thanks.
Is it any easier?
A bit.
You know, eventually you'll need to learn the purl stitch.
I like doing this.
It's only half of knitting.
I know.
She's stable now.
Did she break it?
Her hip? Yes.
How bad?
Bad.
They aren't talking surgery, are they?
No.
Anna hands Joy a piece of paper.
She's in room 1715. Debbie's her nurse until morning.
Anna exits into the kitchen. She returns with several bags.
What are you doing?
Packing. Another nurse will be on call when she returns from the hospital.
What? Why?
I'm done.
But Anna...
I can't work with you.
What?
I'm stumped, Joy. I don't know what to do. You don't trust me. You certainly don't respect me.
What?
You sure as hell don't respect your mother.
How dare you?
She was happy. Joy, happy. When was the last time that you heard her laugh like that? A genuine, honest-to-God laugh.
She was delusional.
How would you know? You were more concerned about her goddamn plants than you were about your mother.
My mother loved those plants.
So?
She planted that lavender when I was 12. She worked on it every single year, babying it, weeding it, caring for it, and the smell, my God. I could get drunk on the smell.
Fucking plants, Joy. Her plants, not yours.
They are mine. They're ours. Everything here is ours. It was always just the two of us. I don't know where she ends and I begin. It all dies with me, Anna. The entire family. All of these beautiful women, the club. When I was born, Mom gave up everything to take care of me. She gave up her own life so I could do whatever I wanted with mine. So I chose to live in my head and think big thoughts and chase stars that are so goddamn far away, I'll never get to them. I chose things that don't matter. I gave her nothing in return.
She was proud of you.
So what? She should have had grandchildren. She should have taught them to grow flowers and dance to Joni Mitchell. She should have had long talks with her granddaughter about boys and life and being true to yourself, everything she did for me. I should have continued the family, made it bigger, given back to her what she gave to me, but I was just too fucking selfish. I always thought there'd be plenty of time, you know? And there was always the next thing, the next degree, then the job, then tenure, then promotion, another book. It never ends, but it does end. I missed my chance to give back to the one person who means anything to me.
Don't forget to take out the trash.
What?
That was the last thing that I said to my mother. Don't forget to take out the trash. We were on the phone, and my daughters were yelling at each other in the other room, and the dog was barking, and the TV was blaring, and I said, "Don't forget to take out the trash." I hung up without saying goodbye. That night, she died of a heart attack in her sleep, the exact way that she wanted to go, peacefully and without pain. But I was furious, and I still am. She was gone in an instant. Your mother is still here, Joy.
She's not.
Why?
I lost her months ago.
Because she doesn't make any sense, and she yells and cries and has blood under her fingernails, and she smells like piss and vomit. So what? That's life. It's her life, and it's all over her.
It's my fault. The whole thing, her cancer, all of it, wholly and undeniably my fault.
It's not about you.
Last year she had a cough. A tiny little cough, but it wouldn't go away. She complained to me about it and I told her to go to the doctor, but she didn't. She said it was just her sinuses acting up, so I let it go. And then she started complaining about her hip hurting. She tripped down a step and strained her muscles, but the pain wouldn't go away. I talked to her on the phone and rolled my eyes because I was busy and she was being stubborn again. And she told me she was going to physical therapy and I told her to push through the pain. I should have left work that minute and gone to see her, but no, I was too damn busy. Another afternoon she called me and told me she was in a dark place and she didn't know how to get out. I didn't understand what she meant. I could have taken a minute, just a stupid fucking minute, and put together that depression is a symptom of metastatic cancer, but no. I thought she just needed cheering up, so I made an appointment. I made a fucking appointment with my own mother
to go to lunch and go shopping. And if I'd given it just an ounce of thought, I would have realized that she couldn't even go shopping because of the pain. I couldn't be bothered to see her, to look at her, to recognize her pain and the warning signs and do everything I possibly could to pull her out of that dark place. I guess it's poetic justice, really, that she doesn't know me. She doesn't recognize me. It's what I deserve. I didn't recognize her. But I understand time, Anna. Somewhere my mother, not this empty shell, is out there. There's a history where I listen to her when she tells me she doesn't feel well. There's a timeline where I listen to her and we go to the doctor in plenty of time and we find the cancer early and she can have surgery and she can live for 20 or 30 more years. That's the history I want.
You can't have it. We all want a time machine, Joy. And hell, maybe it's even possible, but there's not a goddamn thing that you can do about it now, and it doesn't change the fact that your mother is here, right now, hanging on, waiting for you.
What?
She's waiting for you, Joy. She's waiting for you to say goodbye.
I told you, Anna, I'm not spiritual.
I know you're a skeptic, and that's how you do your job. You've got to trust me on this, because this is my job. Your mother is waiting for you. And she is going to stay here in infinite pain for as long as she can until you let her go.
I can't say goodbye to someone who doesn't know me.
You said it yourself. You don't know where you end and she begins. Do you honestly think that that connection would just randomly disappear? Where would it go? It's there. I know it is. You just have to find the key. And you're not going to find it by blaming yourself and running away. This is her shadow self, her living contradiction. Earth and space, flowers and feces, beautiful disease, sublime and messy. Go and see her now. Really, see her. Before it's too late. Listen to what she says. It may not make any sense to you, but that doesn't matter. It's her, and she will know you.
What if she doesn't?
She will.
What if I can't do it?
Then you are missing out on something truly magnificent and immense, terrifyingly immense.
Anna picks up her bags.
Don't go, please.
She shows Anna her knitting.
What happens when I'm done?
Take it off the needle. It's called binding off.
Binding off. Show me.
Anna smiles and puts down her bags. Lights fade. Lights rise. Low, middle of the night. Young George in silhouette.
Mom?
Joy, honey, what is it? Are you okay? What's wrong?
Mom, where are you? I need you.
I'm right here. What happened? You're shaking all over.
I flew.
What?
I was outside. I know you told me I couldn't sleep outside because it wasn't safe and those big dogs roam around at night, but I couldn't help myself, Mom. I'm so sorry.
It's okay, baby. Shh.
Oh, my God, Mom, it was so...
Get under the blanket with me.
But it was Mom. I flew. I really flew. I looked at the stars, and they pulled me up and up, and then the ground went away, and I flew.
That's great. Honey, isn't it?
It was better than the roller coaster at King's Island. Better than anything I've ever felt before. But then I got scared.
Why?
Because I wanted to go so bad, but what if I couldn't come back? I mean, what if I really flew in space and I could see everything I ever wanted, but what if I never came back?
I'd miss you.
I'd miss you too.
Of course you would. But let me tell you something, Joy Gallagher. And I want you to listen. Good. You fly. You hear me? Fly. As high and as far as you want to. And don't let anyone or anything hold you back. You can do whatever you want. And I'll be damned if missing little old me's gonna keep you from it.
But
nothing. From the moment you were born, Joy, I've been letting go of you. Over and over and over again. I gave birth to you, I held you tight, and you wanted down.
I put you down and you wanted to walk. I held your hand and you wanted to run. If you want to fly, then I'll give you wings.
But what about you?
I have my own wings.
Then why don't you fly away?
Someday I will. But not today.
You know what I want?
What?
Chocolate chip cookies.
Now?
Let's bake cookies.
Are you insane? It's 2 a.m.
Lights rise on a hospital bed. Joy crosses to her mother.
Hi, Mom. How are you feeling? I thought you and I could spend some time together. Would you like that? Do you need anything? I have something for you.
Joy reaches into her bag and removes the small scarf she's been knitting.
Look what I did. It's for you. Can I put it on?
Joy delicately wraps the small scarf around her mother's shoulders.
Anna taught me to knit. Turns out I'm pretty good at it. I have an idea.
Joy crosses to her bag and removes a manuscript.
My new book. Maybe we can talk and proof at the same time? Let's see. Quantum entanglement represents the extent to which measurement of one part of a system affects the state of another. For example, measurement of one electron influences the state of another that may be far away, not physically connected in any way.
She makes the note.
Citation, valence. In recent years, scientists have realized that entanglement is present in varying degrees in solid materials, and it is known that 2 entangled electrons exhibit evidence of their entanglement immediately.
During this, George has become uncomfortable. She fidgets and whines.
Mom? Mom, what is it? Are you okay?
Joy goes to George and puts her hand on her forehead, checking for fever. She pulls the blanket up over her.
Better? Geez, that bad, huh? My book is about this phenomenon called entanglement. It's so strange, nobody can explain it. 2 separate things, electrons, photons, are connected so that they behave the same no matter how far apart they are. They can be separated by an entire universe and still behave the same way at the same time, like distant reflections of each other, always. No matter how far.
She opens her bag and removes a bottle of lotion. She rubs it on George's hands.
Chanel No. 5. Your favorite, remember? Share the fantasy. I love that smell. It reminds me of our you and me time. I used to sit on the toilet seat and watch you get ready. You'd let me choose your eyeshadow and we'd talk. About everything. I loved those talks, Mom.
Another idea. Joy rises and finds the CD player. She takes the CD out of her bag and puts it in.
This one is my favorite. You taught me how to slow dance to this, remember? Before prom? God, I was so nervous. What was his name? Ted? Terry? Wonder where he is now.
Joy smiles and sits down next to her mother. George hears the music. As she listens, her hand reaches for Joy's.
Mom? Is it too loud?
No. It's perfect. Hi, baby.
Am I dreaming?
Not unless I am too.
It's you. It's really you.
I love this song.
So do I.
I love you.
I love you too. Mom, I'm sorry. I'm so sorry.
For what?
For not hearing you. He tried to tell me and I was too busy. I didn't understand.
I didn't understand either.
I'm sorry.
So am I.
What for?
Being just is.
Do you need anything?
No. Just this. Do you remember that book I wrote? That silly romance novel?
Yes.
I think you're old enough now. Do you still want to read it?
Oh, yes. Yes, I do.
It's in a box in the attic labeled Dad's Taxes.
Dad's Taxes. Oh, my God. That's what you were looking for.
You remember how disorganized your grandfather was, don't you? Seriously. Would you ever look inside that box? How about something a little more upbeat?
Sure.
Joy crosses to the CD player and presses a button. Big Yellow Taxi plays.
That's more like it. Used to call this the parking lot song.
George rises. Lights shift. Warmth.
Mom, what are you doing?
I'm fine, Joy. Look at me. Bright as rain. Dance with me.
They dance. Lights and sheets, scene shift. Joy lectures.
No one really knows how the art of knitting was invented. It was probably discovered by accident. Someone was playing around with string or rope and realized that a strong, flexible fabric could be formed by looping the string or rope through itself. There are no written records, and textiles themselves don't last long enough for us to determine any archaeological evidence, so we're forced to use our imagination to determine when, in our history, that magical moment might have occurred. You're all looking at me like I'm nuts. Dude, why is she going on about knitting? She's finally gone off the deep end. Or more importantly, is this going to be on the test? Life is so much more than a test, right? So I beg your indulgence for just a little while. And if you listen carefully, there might be some extra credit at the end. If you're wearing a sweater or scarf, I want you to take a look at it. Really take a look at it. Share it with your neighbor. Heck, if you're wearing a t-shirt, that'll work too. It'll just be really, really small. Look closely. What do you see? Loops. Loops passing through loops, passing through loops, passing through loops. That garment, that sweater, scarf, t-shirt, whatever, was woven from a single string. A simple string winds around and around and around itself until its properties change. If I'm knitting in the round, one twist and I make a Mobius. Infinity. Literally. Keep twisting and I can make a Calabi-Yau shape. And you know what that is, right? String theory. That's definitely going to be on the test. It's no accident, I think, that the permeating metaphor for space and time is fabric. The fabric of the cosmos. It's all interconnected. When you pull on a loop over here, it unravels until the stitch falls out all the way over here. And this can explain entanglement, one of the greatest mysteries of quantum physics. So this craft, rooted in our oldest traditions, handed down from grandmother to mother to daughter, reveals to us the nature of infinity. The simplest of necessities, an article of clothing, teaches us something significant about space and time. The practical collides with the theoretical. We're tethered to the earth, and the immensity of history is made manifest in a single silken strand of yarn. Loop passing through loop until it becomes a strong and flexible and lovely fabric. And it keeps you warm, too.
Michael emerges.
Oh, hi. Oh, wow. Hi.
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 Nice lecture.
Thank you.
Look, I just came by. Well, I saw the obituary in the paper. I'm sorry.
Yeah, funeral was last week. I'm kind of at a loss, you know, all this time on my hands.
Sure.
Michael, I am so, so sorry. None of it, I don't even know how to begin to apologize for what I said, how I behaved.
Don't.
Oh, okay.
No, I mean, now's not the time. We have a lot to discuss.
Are you still working at the bar?
Yes.
Can I come by sometime?
If you want to.
I do.
Good. That's good. Anytime. So, I guess I'll see you then.
Okay. He smiles and then exits. Lights shift to the house. A parcel waits by the garden. Joy spies it and looks around for whomever left it. She opens it. Inside is a shawl, the same one Anna was knitting in Act One. Joy puts it on and inhales. She finds her mother's gardening tools. She consults an old paperback.
Lavender plants can tolerate many growing conditions, but it thrives in warm, well-drained soil and full sun. Oh, looks full to me, Jesus, that's bright. Lavender is a tough plant and extremely drought resistant once established, but when first starting your lavender, don't be afraid to give it a handful of compost in the planting soil and keep them regularly watered during the growing season.
Joy looks at the dirt. As she does, old George and young George enter, wearing identical hats, aprons, gloves, and shoes. Joy cannot see her mother's or hear what they say. She speaks to her memory.
Okay, here goes nothing.
She digs.
Do you remember when I was going to name her Raquel?
After that actress.
Yes.
Oh, my Lord. I'd forgotten about that.
I'm pretty sure I didn't inherit your green thumb.
I was only 20. What the hell did I know?
Who knows anything at 20?
And then she was born.
I took one look at her.
And there was joy. So much joy that spilled out of me and all over her.
So that was her name.
I've been trying to wrap my brain around something. I can't tell anyone on campus because they'll think I'm crazy.
Definitely not Raquel.
Dodged a bullet there.
During the funeral, I had this, I don't know, vision, I guess. Or a daydream. Let's call it that. Sounds less apocryphal. No judging. So, in this dream, I saw you. You were right there in the church next to the pastor who was going on about eternal life. You were dancing. You smiled at me, waved, and then you dissolved into a million tiny pieces. They looked like bubbles. It was lovely. And these bubbles of you swirled out into the church and then flew out of a window into the universe. You diffused, but you didn't disappear. You were still you. And you were everywhere, orbiting Alpha Centauri, racing on the tail of a comet, craving a grilled cheese sandwich. You were you. Millions of self-aware little bubbles of you.
It's something like that.
And nothing like that.
Time isn't even a factor. There is no time. The particles are separate, but also the same. So one bubble of you is here, next to me. And another bubble of you is having the grandest interstellar adventure. And both of you still know me. Both of you still laugh at my lame jokes. All of your little soul bubbles are on this massive, epic journey. So happy to explore the universe. So happy to think about me. Little old me, down here on this tiny planet, digging a hole in the ground. And they love me, fiercely.
Old and young George sit on the ground next to Joy.
I love you,
fiercely.
So that's what I want. I'm still me, and you're still you. And when we die, it's as simple as breathing. As simple as me with my head in your lap, you stroking my hair as every mother throughout history has ever done. As simple as that. but still as profound and magnificent as everything. Can I have that?
Yes.
You can.
God, I hope so. I really do.
Lights fade. End of play.
The knitting and the fabric and the string theory and all those things woven together. I was very, very intrigued with that, pulling all of that together.
Kind of that's made cool. Sense for you in some way? Mm-hmm. Yeah? Anybody else? I'd love to know, I'm really curious about, having just seen it for the first time, what's something that comes immediately to mind that you think you're really going to remember? What moment in the story, what point in the play do you think really rang a particular bell with you? Maybe it was a particular conversation or a particular turning point for a character or something about a character. What do you think really rang your bell? Yes.
When she was so angry with Michael.
Yeah?
I was angry with her. And then, as she went on, I began to say, oh, she is so, so sad.
Oh. Yeah. Thank you for that.
I really liked it when the caregiver, the nurse, when I just was ready for you to just smack her. If you're family, then why am I here? I mean, if you care so much. What'd you hire me for? I was waiting for you to either say that or show something and just go, hello? So I like that part.
Cool. What else?
Job, is this is what I do, and
matter what's collapsing around me. And that was an interesting theme through the whole thing. No matter what was going on, she was still lecturing and trying to educate these people. She really clung to that. It's her lifeline when all this chaos was going around. I thought it was, thematically, I thought that was interesting.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
Sarah Jo Marcy on Twitter said she loves joy, certainty, and entanglement versus her not seeing her own tangles.
Oh. Go Twitter. Go Twitter.
Hi.
Yeah, right? What do we think about Joy? If you had to describe her, what kind of person did you take her to be?
Controlled?
Controlling. Say what?
Overachiever.
Overachiever, controlling. What else?
Brilliant.
Say what?
Brilliant.
But insecure.
Typical female professor.
That think so?
Insecure and yet overachiever intellectually and trying to do all of that, and yet other stuff has fallen aside. In relationship with the mother and with Michael.
Good, thank you. How do we feel about the character of George, young and old? What's your take on her? How would you describe her?
I really liked seeing where they intersected.
Yeah.
That was really fun to see when they were like, we both reacted confidently.
Now, I neglected to mention to you before we started that our playwright, Janice, she's actually dead. I know you think she's sitting right here, but she's not, so we can talk about her while she's not. And so I'd love for you to be, let us know if there was any moment in the play where you weren't sure what was going on or you were confused by something. Was there any, just in terms of following the sequence of events, because there's, you know, kind of back and forth with young and old and all that kind of stuff. Were there any moments that weren't clear for you at all? No, nobody's shaking their head. That's good.
The hardest part for me was how clear she became when she went to the hospital. Here's this woman that's been rambling.
Yeah.
And all of a sudden, she's got this clarity, and that was almost too Hallmarkish, or just, it didn't ring quite true to the, I mean, I could have taken a little clarity, but it was...
So that's how it fell on you,
that's
as you were experiencing
how,
it at the
moment.
Because I
love the play.
Right.
But that didn't ring true, that moment. Even though I wanted it to, and I knew what she was trying to go for, it was too much.
Okay, good. Yes, ma'am.
But I've seen that kind of clarity with friends of mine whose parents aren't communicating, and then there's suddenly a moment of clarity shortly before they die.
Yes, ma'am.
She couldn't get up this broken hip.
She wouldn't have been able to get up with the broken hip.
Well, that part, the dancing part,
yeah,
was
right.
Unrealistic.
Anybody else have any moments of lack of clarity for you about stuff?
I accepted that clarity and dancing as her death moment, so yeah. It wasn't literal. I think in staging you might find that there'd be enough theatricality about the moment that you would understand it's her passing.
I see.
At least that's what I thought. My experience with my own mother's death was very similar to that in another plane.
Oh, yeah?
But the reality was her body was dying, but suddenly there was amazing lucidity and physical vibrance that we hadn't seen in her dying state. Mm-hmm. But her death state was different.
Interesting. I mean, staging it, if she danced by herself, but the mother wouldn't be there. She'd dance by herself.
So we would think that it, in the staging of it, we would find a way to embrace the metaphor of it rather than making it literal.
I got all that with just reaching out and holding your hand.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I didn't need the dialogue or the dancing. I got everything that was said and felt in that moment of contact. Mm-hmm. I truly did.
Good. Thank you.
In that scene, I like that she didn't know how to talk to her mother, and she was reading the proof, and you don't know what to say. And if she's gone through all of this, she's not really there anyway. But you don't know what to say. But she got there.
Yeah. Another one from the internet.
Yeah, hate shooting honors.
you both of those sides. When you talk to your friends tomorrow and you say, I just saw this amazing play last night and it was about, what are you going to say? What was this play about for you?
Love.
About love?
And science.
Love and science. Help me think of the science.
Knitting.
Overwhelming, interesting, just enough?
Interesting.
Just interesting.
Relationships.
And relationships, all right.
I think it's a lot about women.
Yeah.
And I'm interested in seeing the development, how it further develops with the male character.
Yeah.
Because I think that opens up a lot of doors to women's relationships with men, and I think that could be fleshed out a little more. But I really, the women were fantastic. And not that you aren't fantastic. But I think the writing, because this is about writing.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
No,
I think the
right.
Fleshing out of the male character with the female, I mean, I think it's needed. I mean, after watching construction of it, but that'll be interesting to see.
Yes, yes. We're mainly laughing because Patrick's like in every reading in this festival.
No, it's fun to laugh at that. I want to see what goes on.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yes, sir.
I thought it was very believable that young George and old George were the two sides of the same character.
Yeah.
That was quite easily believable. I didn't quite believe when she threw him out. I mean, that didn't quite compute for me.
Yeah. Anybody else have any response to the relationship with Joy and Michael?
It was totally believable to me because it seemed like the one thing that she could control.
But that's from her perspective.
Right.
So, like, I was looking at it from his perspective, and I don't even know if he would be that forgiving at the end. I know he said, yeah, we'll work it out, like, at the end, but there's something, I don't know what the answer is.
But that's how it fell on you, yeah. So that's what we need to know, what your response was to that. Yes, ma'am.
Well, it seemed believable that she would do something stupid like that, but I thought it was pretty stupid that what she was doing, and I wanted him to somehow fight for her somehow, and I wanted it to somehow help her with her mother, not just dump him so she could deal with her mother. I sort of wanted that relationship to somehow help her deal with her mother, but that didn't happen. So then at the end, I wasn't really sure whether she's really going to go to the bar ever, and they would actually form a relationship later, now that she's dealt with her mother. Mm-hmm. Wasn't quite sure. That was
or
sort of left open.
Okay, thanks.
To raise the stakes of more stress for her that she has to deal with and rely on the rest of the characters in the play.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Let's talk about what's the highlight for you? What's the one moment in the play that you'd like to go back and see again?
When Anna told her that it's going to be immense, and she better do it, and she will know it, because I've been a pastor, I'm retired now, but I have had experiences where the music and the moment, it happens.
Yeah.
It's not a fakey thing.
Yeah.
It doesn't always happen, I'm sure, but that was a moment I liked, and it was believable enough because of the baggage I bring to it, I guess.
Yes, indeed.
I like that.
Good, good, good. Thank you very much. Yes.
Sarah Jo Morsi said, beginning in wonder, putting wonder in a box, dissolving the box, really awesome echoes of it in the language. And then Hooping Learner says, it's about saying goodbye the only way you can.
Oh. Okay. Thank you.
I'm so low tech, I don't know what he's doing. Now, my wife has explained that to me. that part I got.
She got back to me and she was, look at that. People are Twitter, and then there's all kinds of comments from people who are watching.
I forgot. Okay.
it's fun, isn't it?
Thank you. I thought it was one of those parallel things that was going on. I was confused when she was lecturing.
Lovely. Any other highlights anybody wants to mention before we bring the playwright to life?
I love the music, and I think particularly because music is something that often people with dementia, if they can still go back and sing a childhood song, I thought that really rang.
Yeah, it adds a nice layer to that.
That reminds me of that old guy, Humphrey Lane. Played the violin. He was just as demented as he could be. Roy Acuff.
Oh, Roy.
He could still play.
Yeah.
When he got on stage, he was still Roy Acuff.
Yeah.
But he was not. He had a keeper with him at all times. He just took care of him, aimed him in the right direction.
Wow. Music.
All right, well, we're going to bring Jen back to life so you guys get a chance to meet her. So come on up to the stage.
Personal stuff at work here, and writing this play was something I had to do, but it also kind of terrified me at the same time. But I was my mom. I lost her a couple of years ago to this lung cancer and chemotherapy-induced dementia. And I would go down every Friday to spend time with her during the last summer of her life, and. We just weren't talking to each other, we just weren't communicating, we just weren't connecting. I would sit with her, hold her hand, but there was no really meaningful conversation between us at all. And that's all we did, we talked. Our entire lives together, we just talked about everything. Wow, this is hard, okay. So one day I got an idea. Another thing that she really enjoyed doing with me when I would visit was we would ride in the car together because the movement was soothing and she loved looking out the window and. There were all sorts of, you know, images and things for her to look at. And we would never talk during these drives. At one point I thought, well, let me see what happens if I introduce music into this equation. And so I made a playlist of songs that I knew she liked and that we listened to, just all kinds of songs, mostly stuff from the 70s. And we were driving along and Joni Mitchell's Both Sides Now came on. And I had my hand on the gear shift and I'm looking at the road. And then her hand was on mine. And I looked at her, and she knew me. And she did. And, you know, I said, hi, Mom. And she said, hi, baby. And it was pretty much that scene, you know. And so it does happen, you know, for those of you who have dealt with dementia, it does happen. It's rare, but it happens. And that was the genesis of this play. And I miss her so much. So there you have it.
So. This play's been in lab for a whole season at this point, and here's Jen, and she's willing to answer any questions you might have of her, either about the play itself or about what the process has been like. In putting the play together, you know.
I promise I won't.
Where
do
she
this.
Bought
I'll
those cool
good.
Shoes.
I'm good. All right.
She's good.
Let's
so, what do you want to know? What can Jen tell you?
How old is her daughter?
How old is Joy?
Yeah. In the play, I have her as 30/40s. So the idea is it can
really
be played
know.
By it can be played by an actress. I say late 30s, early 40s. I mean, one of the things that I do as a playwright is I love making really great, meaningful meaty roles for women, yes. Female protagonists.
Yes. Thank you.
And so, you know, the idea that you know, she's the one in the center of this dilemma, and that it was really interesting to hear you comment about Michael, because he was a little bit of a late addition to the process. And as Nate can tell you from early lab time, I really resisted having them romantically entangled with each other. I resisted that because I didn't want to define her through this relationship. And I thought, well, wouldn't it be really fascinating if we just switched it? Because in a lot of times in plays about relationships, it's the woman wanting to be with the man and the man, you know, not wanting to commit and all of that. And we see that all the time. And I thought, well, what if we switch it? You know, what does that do? What if it's the man who really wants to take care of her and she won't let him do it because she's, you know, she's been told that that's not, you know, strong and stuff like that. So it became really interesting, and I agree with you. I think that as I work on the play further, I want to find out more about who he is.
No, I mean, it was really, I mean, her, she's defined, like, mm-hmm. but his response to her mm-hmm. was, there's something that I wanted more.
Sure.
Like, I wanted him not to be as, he's definitely got an identity, but I wanted that really fleshed out.
Sure, mm-hmm. sure.
Because all the other characters are so fleshed out.
Right, and one of the hardest things for me to do was what we've been calling the coda, which is after George dies and he, then we have the lecture and then he comes back. I really do want him to come back because I want there to be some sort of hope that these two, who are obviously, I think, really awesome together, can, you know, can have a future together. And that it's okay if he doesn't finish his dissertation, and it's okay, I mean, if they just live their lives together and be happy. So I want that hope. So I think I'm still trying to figure out how to make that happen.
I think that's important structurally.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Beth.
Have you thought about developing young George's paramour, is it, when he comes in? As a staging of a play, it'd be interesting to see reflection of who she's with follows this other relationship.
That's an interesting idea too. Mm-hmm. It's I don't want a 4-hour play. But yeah. No, seriously.
It could be mini series.
Nate, when he looked at the last draft, he's like, dude, there's so much in here. I said, yes, I know. We got to start cutting this. Like, yeah, because you're right. Absolutely. I mean, it is something I would love.
Fewer characters.
Yeah, the prequel.
Yeah, right.
There's actually early in the lab. Way early in the lab, there was a version of this play with another man, who was Joy's father, who came out of nowhere. And then there was this whole thing. And then I had this really big monologue, and he was this Vietnam vet, and it was really huge. And I was like, okay, well, now the play's about him. This is kind of awesome. So he's gonna come back in another play.
Oh, good. Yeah. Okay. Oh, that would be cool.
I call it Dad's Texas.
Yeah, Dad's taxes, that's right.
What else? Another question from Ms. Blackmer.
I love the Anna thing.
I'm sorry, say?
I just love what you did with Anna, mm-hmm. with the connection around the knitting and putting together the love that she brought and the hair.
Yeah. Anna's kind of an amalgamation of, there's a little bit of me in Anna, there's a lot of my sister, you know, Anna, who was a caretaker for my mom for a while during the end, and she was just so patient and so wise, and so, yeah, the more I work on Anna, the more I just fall in love with her, and Mary just did an awesome job. Mm-hmm. With her, so.
I was just going to say, the one thing that, to tag on with the male character, what I was really, it's how she relates to other humans. Mm-hmm. She's either relating with students or her mother, and now she has an opportunity to actually deal with people who are her equals. Mm-hmm. And she can't deal with her. She has to belittle her.
And then she finally stands up for herself and puts her, you know, they finally, but what I didn't get to see is where, that's, you know, how does she deal with the male? Whether it turns into a romantic relationship or not, you know, great or no, but just to see how she can deal with the opposite sex, because she, either way, she has to be able to deal with people her own age. How does she deal with them? Because from what you've set it up as, she has been raised by a single parent, and it's just them against the world, which definitely creates that control factor. So that's the thing I was lacking, the equal weight to the male side, just to see what happens.
Yes, ma'am.
His issue, though, about the mentor and the senior advisor as opposed to his job as a student, that's a very real issue.
Mm-hmm.
And he was a realist who said, you know, we can't continue this. I mean, I'd like to be with you, but we can't take any more chances. She was dismissing that as not a real issue. I wasn't quite sure, you know. It is a real issue.
It's a huge issue.
Yeah.
It is.
Yes.
Yeah, you're
yes,
just
a teacher.
You? what life experience did that come
from?
My husband read an early draft of the play, and I had to tell him repeatedly that I have not had an affair with a student. pretty much over and over again. So yes, that was, as is most of the play, that was pure fiction.
But there are plenty of tales around the college campus.
Believe me, I know.
Yes, ma'am.
Nick Jagger. Yeah. Are you guys interested in that? I mean, it kind of did go away. And an earlier version of the play, it became this huge thing that she had to deal with, and he'd filed this official complaint, and almost got fired, and all of that. And I didn't want the play to be about that. I think I can probably bring back some of that complexity a little bit. But basically, she, in my head at least, she had enough students. It was just like what Michael said. You know, I can think of 20, 50 undergraduates who would put it all on the line. When they found out she was having trouble, there was a letter writing campaign that basically said, she's awesome, so don't let this be a problem. So that may come back.
I would like that line at mm-hmm. some point after she's had the professor or the dean
mm-hmm.
view her.
Mm-hmm.
I think they should say what the dean got all these letters from the other students.
Yeah, originally, and this actually, I wrote the new Michael scene like a couple of days ago, because originally that was a fully fleshed out scene. That was a big scene, not big, but it was, he came back and they hashed it out, they argued a little bit, and then we learned about the letter writing campaign and all of that, and it almost seemed like the play had three endings. So I was trying to kind of condense it to make the ending itself, which is in the garden with the, you know, the moms, be more impactful. Because with all that before it, then we get to the ending, we're kind of like, okay, is the play over yet? You know, and yeah, so I'll have to kind of take a closer look at that.
Yes, sir.
I always wonder what it is that the playwright really wants an audience member to take home. What would be your major thrust? Because I was jumping all over with all kinds of wonderful things, but what was your intent?
My intent was to make you all want to hug your moms, or think about your moms, or think about friends that you have that may be suffering, or family members that may be suffering from dementia, and don't do what I did, which is to try and figure it out, you know, to fix it. Yeah, I tried to problem solve my way through the entire thing, and you just can't do that. Just have to be with the person when the person needs you. And so probably that, I would say. And my own view of the universe is that it's bigger and grander than we could ever figure out. And so I like people to walk away from my plays at least thinking about that, and thinking about how grand and marvelous this world is, and how we are small, but we are also integral to each other and important to each other. That's it.
I think it's a lovely way to end.
Yeah.
Shall we applaud?
Don't